YouTubers. It's Lost in Space 12-inch Polar Lights Virgin video number one. Back to number one. Got a great show for you today. Great show. I'm actually going to show you the gear wells being cut out to give you a little idea of how it's done. You don't go in there with a bull, you know, with a freaking howitzer or something like that. You start off a certain way, and I'll show you how it's done. I'll do one stage of it, and of course it's repeated several times. Same process goes for the center. And to give you an idea what tools you need, how it's done, and yada yada, here comes the dragonfly. By the way, for all you northerners, they kind of come in and out. It's actually like 85, 86 today. I know, you hate me. You're having a cold spell. And I'm sweating here today, and the dragonfly is going bananas. I didn't plan on that, but of course, no one suspects the dragonfly inquisition. It's a big sucker, too. Anyways, I had a air purifier. You never expect this kind of stuff. Ionizer thing from Evion. You know those big stand-up towers that get all the crap out of the air. And for the last month or so, it's been buzzing and buzzing, and I do the cleaning rod thing, you know, and 20 minutes later starts buzzing again. It really irritated me. I know Smurfs complained, and we decided to use it as a target out back. So there's a little fun clip about that towards the end. Using every weapon technology, short of the laser and a few other things, to put it out of its misery. And, well, you'll see the film. It speaks for itself. What else today? No gizmo of the day today. Although back here I've got Lost in Space Memories playing, which is really cool. There's Bob May. God rest his soul, Bob May. And man, I'm sweating. It is so hot today. It's like summertime. I know you guys are like, ah, kill me. Anyways, it is Tuesday afternoon. I'm only a few days into it. Also remember that when the actual project date, for instance, in this case, was Monday, I've actually been working on it a little bit longer than that. You're probably looking at 4 days worth of work. I rarely take a day off, frankly, because I have no life. Sad. So, without any further ado, let's go on to actually working on the Jupiter 2 hull to give you an idea how it's done. A lot of you will say, you know, no big deal, no brainer. And some of you will be like, oh, that's that how you do it? The thing is to go baby steps, be careful, and especially when you get to the X-Acto knife part, not to cut your finger off. And yes, in the last 8 years, I think I've been to the emergency room at least once for a really nasty cut that required stitches. Part of the business when you're hacking through hard plastic, and although I've learned to guide my blade, still happens. Any professional that tells you he's never cut himself is lying. Let's go on. Okay, with my handy dandy monitor, I can tell I'm centered. Here's your fusion core, and then these legs are marked off. Occasionally I will glance up here. You might see a little hesitancy or something. But I'm going to start cutting on this one here. And I'm going to try to focus in. Now the trick is to have one of these handy dandy Dremel motor tools. This is a particularly powerful one. You don't need one quite that powerful. As a matter of fact, let's see. I think this little puppy, which is the lithium ion handheld type, which I really like. And it's got a bit on there that's seen better days. We're going to go ahead and change that out. Now, the way I like to start, let's see if I've got it in my handy-dandy little rack here. Handy-dandy is the big word of the day. Secret word of the day is handy-dandy. Remember that? Maybe later you win a prize or something. I don't know. And we'll take this little guy out of that chuck. I've got about 8 or 9 of the Dremel tools. They really are handy. You know, you can do with 1 or 2. When you don't want to wait for batteries to charge, even though one of them's got a quick charger and all that. They are probably one of the more useful tools you'll have in your shop. I mean, short of toothpicks and X-Acto knife and glue, it's one of those things I really like. Now, let's see with my little monitor here. Oh, going back. Let's see. Okay, here, we're going to work on this one right here. Yes. Also, remember, when I'm looking at my monitor, everything's in reverse. It's kind of like trying to brush your teeth or your hair in the mirror. Looking in the mirror from the back. All right. If that made any sense at all. I'm going to jack this up to speed. Now, ooh. Woohoo! The power. The power of the Dremel. All right, what we're going to do now is do some guide holes. Remember, this is rather thick plastic. I'm going to do one section here to show you what I'm talking about. And this can apply also to small sections. You know, in this case, it's a 2-inch square section. What you're basically doing is softening up the anime. Make it cheese, baby. Make it cheesy. Like that tiger on those commercials and those things that don't make any sense. You just want to take your aggression out. You know, but don't wander past the line. All right. Next is what we call, defining, refining, whatever you want to call it, making it right. I keep hundreds of these number 11 X-Acto blades around. They're good quality, and they are probably the best quality. I've used other types. They don't last very long. But the trick with these guys is to realize the sharpness doesn't last very long when you're going through thick material. I can change a blade during one of these cuts 3 to 6 times. Depends. Now here, putting on my more intense magnifiers, I will start to refine what I've done. The reason I ink those sections in the first place is when I see the ink disappear, I know that I'm at that point. Using an X-Acto knife requires a little bit of geometric thinking. When you're going into a corner, you can't pull out of it without leaving a slight curve. So what you want to do is go in, and then you get a nice cut. Try to stay inside the line. It's really just like crayon days when you were a kid. Don't go outside the line. Don't cross the stream. Now, I'm not going to do this whole thing. Again, this is very time consuming. The prep time of any model that you're modifying is about 80 to 90% of that model. And I kid you not, guys, when I say I've spent so many hundreds of hours or even thousands of hours on a model, it's not because I'm kidding. That is really the truth. Now notice I got a little curvature here. Takes very little effort to straighten that out. And you follow through. Now you won't get it perfect, because knife cut, again, by human eye, is limited. So what I want to do is this L section here and show you how it's refined. Now this stuff is very thick. Again, your knife travels, ooh la la, off to the happy room to tell them what a goof you are. And that's always sort of embarrassing when you're supposed to be a professional. You can go in at an angle too and get that quarter defined. But do not go past that line. Because then you get into putty nonsense, and I hate putty nonsense. Alright. Now, as a last refinement point, boy is it hot in here, guys. Notice it's pretty good. Oh, let me flip my little screen around here because I'm going totally blind. Alright, here we go. I hope you were seeing that. See, this is the raw side, this is the more refined side. Now here's a little flat-edged file. And there are some slight irregularities, I believe is the word, or screw-ups. Because your knife blade tends to flex. Those X-Acto blades do flex. They curve, they go around things. Path of least resistance kind of a concept.
and you thought modeling was easy. I think not, especially when you have to modify something. Not as easy as you might think. And when I do something for somebody else, a client per se, you know, there's no room for going, well, I tried. No. To those of you who are bored now, you can go away. Those of you who are actually, this is interesting, stay with me. These are very good quality files. There are some less expensive ones. These are supposedly diamond quality. They tend to fall very quickly. One of these little guys can cost you $2. One can cost you $30. It depends. These are quite old. I've had them for quite a long time. And they make this lovely whispering, screaming kind of noise. Which is usually I have the stereo blaring during this, but for you guys, I'm trying to be understood. And although that's not perfect yet, I think it gives you the concept. And again, the reason I did the inking is because I know that once I've gotten rid of all the ink, I'm as good as my diagram was. And if it looks wrong at some point, I can always go in there. You know, sometimes it takes 2 or 3 moves. Sometimes it takes 10 moves. If you try to do an even flow to your filing, you can gauge pretty well. Okay, again, not perfect yet. But notice, there's your raw cut. There's your more refined cut. Now, the last step of this is 2 sandpaper stages. And you'll be like, Jesus! Yes, I know. It's, again, not as easy as you thought it was. Fairly smooth sandpaper. Take the last of that junk out of there. And or if you overlap, because at this point the whole hull needs to be sanded down. That's for gripping the paint, the primer. And also because I like to leave a little bit of lining effect in there, because I like to simulate that stainless steel, something I've talked about before. Right now we're just dealing with this exterior surface. And just like I'm going to do the exterior, which is with this sandpaper, I also use that very fine wet dry sandpaper, which I believe this is 00. And then I'll go in there and smooth it out. It's almost like a smoothing melting process. This stuff is so fine that it tends to get rid of all burrs and all lines of filing and cutting. And again, later on, here, just to show you, since I'm gonna do it anyways, you do a rough and always spiral out from the center because you're trying to simulate a metal object. This is a bonus now, guys. Giving you a little effects. And then smoothing it out, and I'm doing real quick to show you. You go back in with that 00 or even 000, spiraling out from the center to simulate a stainless steel kind of effect, because when you paint over it, although it's not super visible, it is there. And when the light catches it, it's very, very realistic. It's almost like a spider web effect. Again, I'm just showing you very raw, but see the difference. And still not perfect. A little bit of curve right here. Use your instincts, use your eyes. There, better square off. Another hint on this is this square here is always too small for the peg on the leg on this kit. Again, since I've built this thing 1,000 times. Not 1,000, but close. I know to enlarge it. Do your best at keeping it square, because not only does it look nice,
There's no light leaks if you do it just right. And I hope I made it look easy, although really it isn't easy. Some of you building your J2 for the first time of this old Polar Lights kit, I'll tell you, to make it look the way I make it look, I know some people can do it. A lot of good guys out there. Those of you that are more amateur about this and are just starting to get into modeling, you'll find it's a little harder than you think it is. Moving on.
Okay, and to show you, after all that cutting, slicing, and dicing, what something can look like, and let me flip my little screen here so I can see what I'm doing. We miss Steve, and we wish he was here, but since he's got his new job going, I cannot get a hold of him all the time. So, here's the top section that has been refined. Now, notice these cuts here. Same process was used to cut those. The same sanding process. Now, the big thing about the top hull section is that when you join that top to the side section, the entire section together, and you'll see, if I take it off the can, and oddly enough, a spray can fits entirely perfect, makes a great stand. This section here was initially promoted as being the section you took off to see the interior. However, it leaves a lot of nasty lines. Now, what I've done is merge those together so you have a nice seamless hull, which is trickier than you might think. It takes a couple processes. If you've been seeing the shots in between the takes, you'll see that it's about a 2 to 3 step process. What I love about the Rust-Oleum Painter's Touch, and I'm not promoting this isn't some kind of ripoff or sell to you for that product. It is really the best primer I've ever used. Oddly enough, on the label, it does not mention that it works well with plastic. Guess what, kids? It does. And modeling places, hobby stores, and all that will sell you that expensive primer. This is about $3-4 a can, will last through at least an entire model or more, and it's the best stuff I've ever used. So, little hint, little money saving. Yay! So this guy's prepped. It's gone through, you know, not as much as the bottom hump. The bottom hump really does get cheesed into, cut, sliced, diced. But this shows you how pretty and how seamless it can be if you do the technique I've showed you. In this case, I've used, epoxy sculpt and gone around. Of course, it takes a day or two. Epoxy sculpt. And it takes a day or two to dry correctly. Then you sand. And the second or third primer coat should be just right. The beauty of the Rust-Oleum is that it reveals those little tiny segments and cracks that aren't visible until it dries and it settles. And you'll see, oh, there's a little gap there and all that, which is, of course, is an eyesore. And on a super futuristic spaceship, shouldn't be there. So anyways, I'm going to write it off at this point. End the film, and there's a little ditty at the end showing what happened to the old air purifier, which is now resting in pieces. Take care.